Oh, how I long to breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me, walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord.
And every prayer prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, at the end we'll see it all was worth it when you returned to wipe away our tears.
There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more, standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And on that day we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith. And with one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Shall reign. Oh, will you reign? So let it be today. We shout the hymn of heaven with angels and the saints. We raise a mighty roar. Glory to our God. Keep us life beyond. So let it be today. We shout the hymn of heaven with angels and the saints. We raise a mighty roar. Glory to our God who gave us life beyond the grave. Holy, holy is the Lord.
Holy, 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 holy. lift our voice.
Holy, 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 holy is the Lord.
Holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy is the Lord.
Holy, holy, holy,
holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy, holy is the Lord.
Yes.
Holy, holy, holy.
We join our voices with the angels and we declare, holy, holy, holy,
holy.
Worship Him like He's worthy to be praised in this house. Lift your voice and praise Him right now.
A couple weeks ago, we had a special visitation of the Holy Ghost. It was the first Sunday that I was back after being gone there in February, and I got up and began to just share about the outpourings of the Holy Spirit that have happened in our nation in different places. And before I even got to read my text, there was just a touch of the Lord, and I just felt like I couldn't go on. And we just began to pray, and it was a unique move of the Holy Spirit where for about 20 minutes, all we did was just pray in this room. And just an anointing of intercession and spontaneous prayer that occurred. And that led to just an extended time in the altar, and God did many things. And I went home that day, and I edit the video for the cable TV and for YouTube, and so they give me the thing, and I go through, and I edit it, and I mentioned to Jessica, I said, well, I'm not sure what to edit here, because I really didn't preach my sermon this morning, but I just said, you know what? I'm just going to put the whole thing on there. So people are just tuning in. They're just on television. They're just going to hear our church in prayer. They're just going to hear praying. And we're praying in English, and we're praying in the Spirit. And as I was standing up here and hearing all of you pray, I thought of how beautiful. It was like a roar. It was just a beautiful sound of the church in prayer, in repentance, in coming before the Lord. And during that time, I was walking right over here, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me and gave me some instruction to give to you. I've went back and re-listened to that video multiple times. And the Lord said, had me share with you, the Holy Spirit is taking you to the next level in intercession. Cry out to the Lord right now. You have an audience with Him right now. Use your voice. And the Lord's reminded me of those words over the last couple weeks. And this morning, I believe He wants to speak to us on that subject. I want to share with you just on this subject for a few minutes. Use your voice. Use your voice. In this day and age, when parents realize that their kids are being a little bit too loud, oftentimes I hear them say, as a reminder gently to their children, use your inside voice, right? When I was little, I never heard that when I was little. Our warnings were somewhat more abrupt than that. I didn't know there was an inside voice and an outside voice. I was just instructed, stop using your voice. Sometimes we do that to try to encourage them, you need to speak, but speak more quietly. In our culture, there's a movement, and they'll use some form of this phrase, use your voice, and they're encouraging people, you need to stand up and let your opinion be known. You should use your voice. Make your voice known. You need to get out there. Don't let somebody trample on your opinion and your idea and your voice. You use your voice. And I'm not using that phrase in that context. I'm not encouraging you to make your opinion known. I am encouraging you today, biblically, a little bit differently, that we have an imperative from Scripture, from the Lord, to use our voice for Him. Not for my opinion, or my thoughts, or my idea, or what I think. But I need to use my voice to say what the Lord is saying. I'm going to be jumping around a little bit in Scripture today, but just for a text, Psalm chapter 3, verse 4. David said, I cried to the Lord with my voice, and he heard me from his holy hill. You know, he could have said, I cried to the Lord, and he heard me. And we would think it would mean the same thing, but he didn't say that. How many know God's very specific in his word? And he didn't just say, I cried to the Lord, where someone might misinterpret and think he was just weeping or that he was just silent. No. He added the phrase, I cried to the Lord with my voice. He heard me when I used my voice. Now, I believe that you can pray silently and God hears. And I do that. I believe there's a time for just quiet meditation in His presence and listening to the Lord. I believe that. I practice that. But I think sometimes we need to have also the encouragement that we need to cry to the Lord with our voice. Are you hearing your pastor today? David was not in a situation of just, man, this is wonderful, and I just feel goosebumps and the glory of the Lord. He was actually in trouble. He was actually saying, he was fleeing from Absalom, who was trying to kill him. And he was saying, when I was in deep trouble, when I was in fear for my life, other people might be over hunkered in a corner crying, but I didn't just cry. I cried out to God with my voice. And when I was in trouble and I cried, God heard me from His holy hill. Now His holy hill is where He reigns from. That's where His throne is. That's the representation of heaven. And David is giving us a key in the Word of God. When you're in trouble, you may feel like God is a trillion miles away. You may feel like I couldn't get to God anyway. He's way off somewhere in heaven. If I was on the bridge of the Starship Enterprise going warp 9.9, I'd never be able to get to where God is. But it doesn't matter what you feel like. When you cry out loud with your voice, he said, I'm up here on my holy hill, and all of a sudden there's angels around the throne, and they're saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord. There's all of this worship that is happening in heaven, but God says, wait a minute, right now my voice is tuned to one of my children right over there in Conneaut, Ohio, who just cried out to me with their voice, and I'm hearing them from my holy hill. When you cry, He hears. Your cry is reverberating through the halls of heaven. Just let that sink in for a moment.
You thought in the middle of the night you were all alone and you didn't know who to call, and you started crying out to the Lord, and your voice, somehow God just had an angel come over with a supernatural microphone and put it right in front of your mouth, and that thing is reverberating all through heaven. Your voice is heard, and God's saying, I hear you in my holy hill. Your voice is coming up to me, and I will hear. And what God hears, he answers. Aren't you glad God's not off somewhere, uninvolved? You have access to him. I said, you have access to him. You think, well, I don't have access like the preacher has access. I mean, I don't have access like somebody else has access. I mean, they pray all the time. He doesn't hear me. It's a promise from the Word. When you cry to the Lord, he will hear you. He's never too busy. I've never had God, when I've called on him, say, I'm sorry, Carson, I just don't have time for you right now. I've never had God tell me, nope, just you're just going to have to wait. I've got too many people in line ahead of you. You know, everybody's God's child, but I think I'm his favorite. Because he's never too busy for me. I don't know how you feel, but you're his favorite too. God loves you. If God has a refrigerator, your picture's on it. He loves you. He loves you enough to hear every time you cry. When you cry out with your voice. Now, God gave you a voice to use for him. God gave you a voice so that you would use your voice for him. I just want to ask you to evaluate this week. What things have you used your voice for? Maybe you've used your voice for a whole lot of things. You might have used your voice to get your kids' attention. You might have used your voice loudly to get your kids' attention. You might have used your voice to give somebody directions when they were trying to find where they were going. Maybe you used your voice to order a pizza this week. Maybe you used your voice to tell somebody at work about a situation that's going on and how you're going to have to get that fixed. And maybe you used your voice to communicate to your spouse how much you love them. Maybe you used your voice in anger this week. Maybe you used your voice in gossip this week. Maybe you used your voice to cut somebody down behind their back when they didn't know about it. Maybe you used your voice to slander someone and to speak negatively of them. Maybe you used your voice to expose someone. Maybe you used your voice to bear false witness. Maybe you used your voice in cursing this week. Maybe your frustration came out in your voice. James talks about that flows out of us, and he says something unique. He said, from the same well can't proceed sweet water and bitter. And if we're corrupting our words with bitter water, cursed water, we can't turn around and just turn that spigot off and then turn it back on and think, oh, now it's good water. If you had tainted water with poison in it come out of the spigot yesterday, I don't think you'd walk up to the spigot today and go, oh, let me get a big glass of water and drink it. Because you would think, wait a minute, this is tainted. This is corrupted. And we need to be very aware of our words so that we are not using corrupt words. Maybe you used your voice this week
to share your heart with someone, maybe to give spiritual direction, maybe use your voice to bless somebody, maybe use your voice to encourage a brother or sister in the Lord. Maybe you used your voice to talk to God and to intercede and to stand in the gap. God gave you a voice so that you would use your voice for Him. Everything else we use our voice for is just words. Man, I can get a room quiet. Everything else is just filler. I can communicate my thoughts and my ideas and my desires and my opinion and what I think and my experience, and a whole lot of it is meaningless and worthless. But if I use my voice for Him, it's different. When I use my voice for the Lord, then God's anointing comes on my voice. Hear your pastor today. God wants to anoint your voice. I said, God wants to anoint your voice. God wants to set your voice apart so that it is set aside and consecrated for Him, for holiness, not for worldliness. Is that good? If you, and I'm not going to go in and read all the scripture, but if you go back to the book of Samuel, Samuel's a young boy. Samuel is staying with Eli the priest, and he's here, he's in the house of the Lord, and his job is, you got to make sure that the fire doesn't go out. You got to make sure that there's oil in there. And so Samuel is sleeping, and he hears his name being called, Samuel, Samuel, and he runs to Eli, and he said, what do you want? And Eli said, that wasn't me. Go back to bed. You just ate too much pizza. And he goes back, and he's back in there asleep. And again, he hears, Samuel, Samuel, and he runs to Eli. And Eli said, buddy, that was not me. And finally, you know, Eli gets what's happening, and he said, wait a minute. You're hearing a voice. And it wasn't my voice. And there's nobody else here. That was God. So if you hear that voice again, here's what you say. You say, speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. Right? And so Samuel hears again the call of his name. And he says to God, speak, Lord. Your servant is listening. And Samuel not only listened to the Lord, but then Samuel was a mouthpiece for the Lord. God anointed Samuel that whatever he said, God would accomplish. Because he didn't speak of his own. He only spoke what God told him. And God did something very unique. And you'll see it in 1 Samuel 3. It says, God let none of his words fall to the ground. None of his words failed. None of his words just came out of his mouth and went, pfft. I'll be the first one to tell you, a whole lot of my words go, pfft. A whole lot of things are because I'm thinking them. Because this is my opinion. And I have a tendency to let my words get away from me. Nobody else in the room has that happen. And I don't know how many times I will rethink through a conversation and think, oh, why did I say that? I shouldn't have said that. And I'll go back to the Lord and say, Lord, would you cover me in that? God, I repent. And then oftentimes I'll have to go back to the person and say, I said that, I didn't mean that, and I want to apologize to you. Would you forgive me? I didn't mean to say that way. Nobody else in the room's ever had to do that. I'm sure I'm all. If there's anybody, just slip your hand up real quick. We're like, okay, that's good. You made your pastor feel. I was ready to just walk off the stage. Y'all look so holy, and I thought I'm the only one. I don't know about you. When I begin to share from me, it falls to the ground. But when the anointing of the Lord comes on your voice, and He uses your voice, the Lord will accomplish everything He speaks. Now, we're called to lift our voices in prayer. I don't know about you, but too often I have idle words come out of my mouth. Jesus talked about that. He said in Matthew 12 that we will give an account for every idle word. That idle means, it's the Greek word argos, and it means free from labor, at leisure, lazy. I have a lot of lazy words. I have a lot of things I just say. They're just idle words. You know, when my car is idling, you know what's happening? The car is in park, the engine's running, it's burning fuel, but it's not getting you anywhere. You can hit the gas pedal and it'll make noise and rev up, but it's not accomplishing what it was intended to accomplish, which is transportation. It was intended to get me somewhere. And sometimes our words are idle. They make a lot of noise. They're revving up over here, but they're not accomplishing what they were intended to accomplish. God gave you a voice so that you would use your voice for Him. And if you're having idle words, then it's not what God's called you to. God's called us to lift our voices in prayer. One of the most effective ways to use your voice is calling on the name of the Lord. When you don't know what to do, call on the name of the Lord. When you feel like there's no hope, you call on the name of the Lord. When you feel like I don't see the answer, you call on the name of the Lord. When you say, but I've prayed about it 100 times already, you call on the name of the Lord. When you feel victory, call on the name of the Lord. When everything's going wonderful, call on the name of the Lord. When the sun's shining, call on the name of the Lord. In the black of midnight, call on the name of the Lord. If you use your voice to call on the name of the Lord, it's the highest use of your voice that you could have is to communicate with the Creator of the universe. Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3, he said, call to me and I will answer you. And I will show you great and mighty things that you know not of. Literally, in the Hebrew, he said, I will show you hidden things. I will show you fenced in things, things that you cannot see, that you cannot view any other way. But when you call on me, I'll give you revelation. What's he saying? He's saying, when you call to me, it's not a one-way conversation. When you begin to call to me, I'll begin to give you revelation. I'll begin to show you things. Now you need to catch this, so that you'll call on me more. So that we'll start in a dialogue. Because if God's saying, if you will submit your voice to me in prayer, I will give you revelation of things other people don't know so that you can pray it. Because when you pray it and intercede, that gives Him the ability to be able to accomplish it. Wesley said, God does nothing on this earth save in response to believing prayer. I've heard people say, well, God's going to do what God's going to do. It doesn't matter if we pray. God just is going to be. You know what? If that's the case, then why would we pray? I believe that God moves when His people pray. As a matter of fact, you can look in the Old Testament and see times when God restrains Himself and does not accomplish His will because He did not have anyone to stand in the gap and to make up the hedge. He sought for just one. If I could just get somebody to pray, if I could just get somebody calling on me, if I could just find a team of intercessors, if I could just get a group over there in Conneaut who'll get in the altar and lay themselves before me and pray until I give them revelation so that they pray the revelation back to me so that I can give them even deeper revelation and we have a continual conversation, then we're going to see the power of God move in this area like never before. The problem is we quit too soon. You need to write down what God says and pray it back to Him over and over and over and over. You need to be diligent in prayer. And that's what God's calling us to be. Our voice should be filled with God's word. Our voice should just be dripping with the anointing of this book. We ought to have this book. We ought to just in this book day and night. Psalm 1 says, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law does he meditate day and night. And he will be like a tree that's planted by the rivers of water that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does will prosper. The ungodly are not so, but they're like the chaff that the wind drives away. Therefore, the ungodly will not stand in the judgment, nor sinners in the congregation of the righteous. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous, but the way of the ungodly shall perish. We ought to just have the word in us all the time. Is it in you? Is it in you? You know how you get the word in you? You have to get in the word. You just got to dive in. You just got to read his word. You just got to have that word. And I'm getting in the word, so I'm going to let the word get into me. And then when you face a situation that's bigger than you, you stop talking about what you're thinking and what you want and what this one said and that advice. And then you start saying, but I just felt like the Lord led me to a scripture over here. And God was just telling me, and this is what I've been praying, and God's been speaking over me. Is that good? You know, even our prayer can sometimes be so filled with our will rather than his will. I know you haven't had that happen. But sometimes if we allow it, our prayer life is just giving God our laundry list of things so that he will know what to do today. Because he's unaware. I have to inform God of things I need him to take care of for me today. Now, the Bible does say in Philippians that we are to make our requests known unto God. And that's part of our prayer life. But I think too often, especially in Pentecostal and charismatic circles, prayer becomes this formula. And I've heard people, they'll say, okay, we have to recite this and we have to say this. And I, you know, before I get out of bed in the morning, I have to recite this and say that. And too often what happens is people are trying, they're thinking they're manipulating God some way to get their will done. It is closer to witchcraft than it is biblical intercession. We don't need to follow, okay, I've got to say this just right, and I've got to say that, and you know what prayer is more about? It's not about me getting God to do my will. It's really about me saying, God, I want to bend my will to you. God, I want to submit myself to your will. God, let your will be done. God, I want to pray your will. God, I want to intercede that your will is accomplished here, even if it's different than what I think or what I want or what's easy for me or what's comfortable for me. God, I want your will. I've heard some Christians pray, and they spend more of their time talking to the devil than they do talking to God. They spend time telling the devil all these things that he's supposed to do and not do. And I'm commanding the devil this and telling the devil that and doing this. You know what? Maybe we should spend a little more of our time saying, you know what? I've got an audience with the creator of the universe. Why would I waste my time on the devil? I'm going to pray to God. God's going to hear from heaven. The devil's going to flee because he's not going to want to be around the glory and the anointing and the presence of God that comes when the church joins our voices together in prayer. I just think we need to say, God, I want your will. God's will is always according to this book. This book. So if you haven't been reading this book this week, you're probably in danger of not walking in his will. Because his will for you is to be in the book and get the book in you. I've had people say, well, I can't memorize scripture. There's a whole lot of different ways you can do it, but I would tell you that there's a whole lot of other things you can quote. I've heard people quote, they can almost quote an entire movie. They've watched it so many times. You can quote songs. You can quote all other kind of stuff. And then people, well, I can't memorize a verse of scripture. I don't think we really have any excuse. We need to be in the book continually. And then we need to use our voice to pray the book over every situation. There are times when I'm praying over people, specifically at the altar, and the Lord will give me a prophetic word for them. Now, that doesn't happen often. That's certainly not all the time. But very often, when I go through and I start praying over people, the Lord just gives me a scripture to pray over them. And I will begin to just pray a scripture. And so while I'm praying, I'm just praying the word. And can I say there's no better way to pray than when you pray the word back to the one who wrote the word? Is that good? See, my words don't have power. His word has power. See, God's word never returns void. It goes where he sent it. It accomplishes everything he intended for it to accomplish. This word right here, heaven and earth will pass away, but this word is not going to pass away. So we've got to stand firmly on God's word. There's power in the word of God. You want your words to be filled with power? Stop letting them be your words and let it be God's word that comes out. His word is like a two-edged sword. That's what his word is. It pierces even to the dividing asunder of soul and spirit. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of the heart. His word is powerful in our lives. So we got to get in his word, so we get his word in us, so that then we pray his word back to him. Now, can I encourage you? You should know what God's word says about salvation. How many of you here have been saved longer than 6 months? You should be able to tell me what God's word says about salvation. If not, that's where you need to start. Get the Romans Road so that you could very easily tell people, well, the Bible said that we've all sinned and we've all fallen short of the glory of God. Right? And then Romans says the wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord, right? You need to get that inside of you. You need to know that Acts chapter 2 says, it will come to pass that whosoever will call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So that God can use you with someone who's unsaved to be able to let his word come out of you. So that you can pray that back to him. You should know what God's word says about salvation. You should know what God's word says about deliverance. So that when you run across someone who needs delivered, you know exactly how to pray. Are you hearing your pastor? You should know what God's word says about healing. So that when someone needs healing, you can say, well, Psalm says that he sent his word and healed them. And so we're praying the word right here. And then Isaiah chapter 53 says he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement that brought us peace was on him, and by his stripes we are healed. Right? He said, I am Jehovah Rapha, the God that heals you. James said, is there any sick among you? Let him call for the elders of the church and let them anoint him with oil in the name of the Lord, and the prayer of faith will save the sick and the Lord will raise him up. You should know what God's word says about healing. Are you hearing your pastor today? You need to know what God's word says about direction, about anointing, about the glory of the Lord, so that you can pray those things and use your voice. You know, I believe when we start declaring God's word rather than our will, there'll be a new anointing on our voice. We're going to join. We've done this for several years. The Lord spoke this to me back several years ago, and I brought it back and talked to other pastors in our community. And we've done on the National Day of Prayer, we have joined with churches all over our community, and we're going to do it again on May 4th. It's a Thursday. We're going to be outside City Hall, right on Main Street in Conneaut, and we are going to start at 8 in the morning, and we're going to have a reader there, and you'll be able to sign up for a slot just to start reading God's Word. So we're going to start right in John, right? In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God, and all things were made by Him. Without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was light, and the light was the life of men, and the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. That's the first thing we're going to declare over the city of Conneaut from City Hall on the National Day of Prayer. We're going to read His Word at from 8 a.m. to 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., 11, 12, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 o'clock in the evening. We are going to read through the New Testament and declare it over our city. And then we're all going to join together at 6:18 p.m. At 6:18, we're going to have a prayer service together. 6:18, because Ephesians 6:18 says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. So it doesn't matter if you're Pentecostal or if you're from any other church, we're going to pray together in the Spirit at 6:18. We're all going to join together. We're going to pray. And I believe God hears from heaven when His Word is declared over our city. I'm believing for change in Conneaut, Ohio. Is anybody with me? In the Old Testament several times, and I just, because the Lord had spoke this word to me, I started looking up the instances where the phrase is used, they lifted their voice. And it is used many, many times. They lifted their voice. And starting in Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, for 13 books, all the way from Genesis through 1 Chronicles, every time it's used in a hard time, in a difficult time. It's used in a time of judgment of God on sin. It's a time when they've went into sin. It's a time of defeat. It's a tragic time. It's a time of someone's has died. It's always used as a negative. But that changed in 2 Chronicles. It's the first time that that phrase is used in Scripture in worship. When they lifted their voice in worship. And it was when they built the temple and they were dedicating the temple. And that phrase that had always been used about judgment, about death, about sin, about tragedy, all of a sudden, that phrase was transformed in one day. And here's when it happened. 2 Chronicles chapter 5, verse 13. Said, it came to pass as the trumpeters and singers were as one to make one sound to be heard in praising and thanking the Lord. Notice the emphasis on unity. When you use your voice, you need to use your voice in unity with others in the body of Christ. We need to be united in prayer, church. If y'all are Pentecostal, I'll give you permission to say amen. We need to lift our voices as one. We need to be of one heart and one mind. How does that happen? It doesn't happen by one person having a good idea and everybody say, oh, that's a good idea. Let's go with that. It comes by the Holy Spirit moving in our midst, that we're led by the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is like the conductor of the orchestra of heaven. It's almost like the Holy Spirit tells each person how to play their instrument just at the right time in the right way so that the whole thing all comes together. And He's doing that in the body of Christ. He's calling the church to pray and He's putting all of that together because I believe this year we're going to see the glory of the Lord flood the earth. I believe God is ready to move in a powerful way. And you don't know how to pray? Romans chapter 8 says we don't know how to pray as we ought, but the Holy Spirit himself makes intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. For the Spirit searches all things, yes, the deep things of God, and he always prays according to the will of God. You don't know how to pray? You just start praying in the Spirit. All right, I better keep reading here. Second part of verse 13. And when they lifted up their voice with the trumpets and cymbals and the instruments of music, and they praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. That then the house was filled with a cloud, even the house of the Lord. When unity came in and they decided we're not going to lift up our voice in mourning and weeping. We're not going to lift up our voice because of tragedy and defeat and judgment. We're going to lift our voice and declare together who our God is. Great is the Lord and he's greatly to be praised. When they came together in unity and they lifted their voice, the glory of the Lord filled the house of the Lord. Look at the next verse. So that the priests could not stand to minister by reason of the cloud, for the glory of the Lord had filled the house of God. Lord, do it this morning. Let your glory fill this house as we lift our voices. We use our voices as you have intended for you. We use them in worshiping you. We use them in calling on your name. God, fill this house with glory. You see, there's a lifting of our voice in worship and intercession. I've always known that there is this incredible connection between worship and intercession, but over the last several months, the Lord just keeps bringing this back to me. Lifting our voice in worship and intercession. Now, when I'm worshiping, it's just a normal thing for me to begin to have the Lord speak something to me. Do you have that? We come in, and man, this team does such a phenomenal job. We're so blessed. And they just begin to lead us in worship. And the Lord begins to move. And it's often that the Lord will speak a word to me just during that time. And you'll see me sometimes, I'll stand and then I'll be sitting down and I'll get my iPad out and I'll start writing because the Lord just spoke something to me while we were praying. And 2 weeks ago, we're worshiping the Lord and the presence of the Lord was powerful in the room in worship. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, start walking. Now that was a little different. And I said, okay, Lord, I'll start walking. And there were a lot of people up front that day. The house was pretty filled, so there were people all over up front. And I kind of had to walk in between people and zigzag a little bit, and I'm just walking and praying. And the Lord was speaking things to me to pray over our church, and I just started walking, and I got over here to the speaker, and I'm just praying and worshiping the Lord, and I'm interceding. And the Lord said, turn around and look. And I stood over here while y'all were worshiping, and I just looked back over the congregation. Now, there were some people that were exuberant in worship. There were some people that were just, you could tell, they were just enjoying the joy of the Lord in worship. There were other people that were singing. There were some people that were just, that were quiet, and some were just kind of sitting in the presence of the Lord, and I think some maybe were distracted and not really focused on that. And I just began to say, Lord, I thank you for a spirit of worship. Thank you for worshipers. And the Lord spoke to me and he said, they are intercessors. When we begin to worship, there ought not be a separation between worship and intercession. It ought to just flow naturally. It ought to be that we begin to, because when we worship him, his presence comes. Worship attracts the presence of the Lord. And when that happens, God's presence just comes. In John chapter 4, he said, those who worship in spirit and truth, the Father is seeking, not the worship. He's seeking those who worship him. He's seeking the worshipers. He's looking. When you worship, he's looking. Sunday morning at 10:30, and that's certainly not the only time, but when we come together in this church Sunday morning at 10:30, and this team says, let's worship, he's looking. And he's not just looking in this room. He's looking for those of you that are watching in your home, because you need to make that a place of worship. In a few minutes, we're going to worship in this room. And don't just sit back and go, oh, listen to what they're singing. Make that, just crank the music up and sing and worship the Lord right there in your home. And let that, just that atmosphere of worship change the atmosphere in your home today. I prayed about that this morning. I prayed for you that are watching today. Worship and intercession should just fold together naturally according to Scripture. True worship attracts the presence of the Lord, and God's presence dwells where there's worship. God's glory comes where there's worship. We just need to get in His presence and then start listening. There are some times when we just listen and the Holy Spirit starts speaking a word. So then, now I've been worshiping Him, but now I begin to pray back to Him what He's saying. While we were on vacation, we went to a couple churches, and one church, I know the pastor there, he's been a blessing to us, and so I was looking forward to hearing him preach. We got there, he wasn't preaching. They had a missionary there that day, and which he was good, but I didn't get to hear the pastor preach. And I was disappointed at the beginning of the service when they announced that he was preaching. I thought, I didn't come to hear him. I came to hear Pastor Turpin preach today. I wanted to hear him preach today. But you know what? The Lord did not have me there for me to hear. Because as they began to worship the Lord, God began to speak to me things about their church. God began to speak to me about their pastor and his wife. And I began to just intercede. There was a great worship service, but I began to pray over that church. And I thought, Lord, you brought me here today, not for me to get something. You brought me here today so that in worship I could intercede back to you over this church. And I'm just praying your blessing over this congregation, over this pastor, because he's weary. He's been through a difficult time. I don't know what it is, but I know he's been through a hard time. This church is trying to get vision, and they're moving, and they're moving forward. But God, they need breakthrough here. There needs to be a fresh anointing come in here. And so I start praying as the Holy Spirit is given me. Church, I'm trying to help you to realize that ought to be the reaction of every one of us in worship. We shouldn't be able to get distracted in worship because it's not about us. Is that good? It's about us coming to the Lord, having His presence come, so that then we can get to the real stuff where we're using our voice in prayer and intercession to cry out to Him. It's this marriage of worship and intercession. It happens in Revelation chapter 5. In Revelation chapter 5, it said, now when he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, each having a harp. That represents worship. David, the worshiper who played on the harp. And golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints. Worship and prayer. Worship and intercession. They just go hand in hand. Hand in hand. Now let me close with this. God gave you a unique voice. You know, when you hear somebody on the phone, even if you don't have caller ID, as soon as you hear their voice, you know exactly who that is. Because you know their voice. God gave you a unique voice. Your voice is different than everybody else. God gave you in worship a song that nobody else is to sing, but God gave you a song. Are you hearing me? Now, that doesn't mean you need to sing loud. Some of you are gifted as singers, and some of you are gifted to make a joyful noise. God gave you a testimony that only you can give. God gave you a prayer that you are assigned to pray. Are you hearing your pastor? So there's a mantle of intercession over this church. And now I ask you, will you take up your mantle? Will you take up the mantle and say, it's not just about me receiving something in worship. I'm going to get into worship so that I can hear the voice of the Lord clearly, so that then I'm going to get in the altar and I'm just going to linger in the altar. I'm just going to linger in His presence. And as He speaks something, I'm going to pray it back to Him. And I'm going to start this conversation with the Lord. And I'm going to use my voice to speak God's word over situations. Jesus said, well, if these don't praise me, then even the rocks will cry out. Somebody's got to use their voice. Somebody's got to cry out. Somebody's got to praise me. Somebody's got to stand in the gap. Somebody's got to pray. How many of you say, Pastor, it'll be me? If that's you, stand to your feet and say, Pastor, that's me. I want to be the one. If nobody else is there, I'm going to be there. I want to be the one worshiping. I want to be the one in the altar. I want to be the one in intercession calling on the name of the Lord. Now here's what I want to encourage you today. You got to use your voice. Use your voice. So you say, well, I'm not comfortable doing that out loud in front of everybody. They're not your audience. Your audience is on His holy hill. David said, I cried out with my voice and He heard me from His holy hill. He's listening this morning.